I am Anna Galletly, and we're going to do a short video lecture on Unit 3, the cardiac physiology, also called heart physiology. All right, so with the heart muscle, we've got three layers. Actually, this slide isn't correctly. Three layers to the heart. Okay, the only one that is muscle is the middle one, and that is myocardium. So myo meaning muscle, and that is the only part that's actually cardiac muscle. The outer layer, so epi means outside or around or about or, the outside. The epicardium is actually made out of visceral pericardium, so it is serosa. There is also the parietal pericardium, right? And this is what forms the sac that is holding everything in it. The epicardium, that visceral pericardium, it is a very, very thin layer. It is wet. Once you pull the heart out of the cavity, it dries out really fast and disappears. So it's very, very thin. Endo means inside. So the endocardium is the lining of the chambers or valves. So the fancy word for that is endothelium. But this is the same thing as saying epithelium and the lumen of cardiac vessels. Okay, so this could be the heart, this could be blood vessels. Okay, so this is going to be a simple squamous epithelium. Okay, next slide. All right, we're going to start looking at some pictures of the histology of the myocardium. This is review from A&PII, so you need to remember the striated branches, 1 to 2 nuclei, the intercloided discs, which create the functional syntheme, and the intercloided discs have two structures in them, desmosomes and gap junctions. The gap junctions are what allow the syntheme to occur, so charged ions can move between the cells. Desmosomes are what cause the intercloided discs to stain darker. So they absorb more stain, and the desmosomes, you'll remember, are a special type of junction that helps keep cells from being further apart. All right, next slide. All right, so here is your classic cardiac cell. So this is one cell, and you can see how it has this branching pattern right here. Here are the intercloided discs that are absorbing more stain. And then you can see we've got a couple of nuclei kind of squashed in here or there. So branching pattern, super important. Intercloided discs, super important for you to know and know their function. All right. Here we're actually looking at a slide of the cardiac cell. And it's hard to see, but you can see the intercalated discs pretty readily here. So I'm marking several of these. Let me move this up a little bit and expand it. Well, actually, that's a little too expanded. Okay. And then trying to find a good one here. You can kind of see, so here's a thing right here. This is actually not a great example of the branching pattern. Let me see if the next slide is better. All right, so here's another slide, right, of cardiac cells. And this one is using a pink stain. And what you'll notice is that sometimes with the pink stains, or even with the black stains, you don't see the intercalated discs very well. What I can say is that I can see some very faint striations. Okay, so you got striations. So if you see striations, you can rule out smooth muscle. Now, if I look at this, I'm seeing cells that kind of look a little bit short to me. And maybe some, you can see some of the branching patterns up in here now. All right. So this does not look to me like smooth, like skeletal muscle. So that helps as well. So here you can kind of see some branching. Okay. All right, next slide. All right, so that's about it for the histology. So let's look at the conduction system. You have intrinsic and extrinsic. The extrinsic is controlled by the autonomic nervous system, so it's involuntary, okay? And what I want you to remember is that one side speeds it up, that's gonna be sympathetic, and one side slows it down, and that's gonna be sympathetic, and specifically, the vagus nerve. And this is, again, review from A&P I. You should have it already memorized that the vagus nerve's job with the heart is to slow it down, okay? Then you've got the intrinsic conduction system, also called the nodal system. And that starts with the SA node, the AV node, the bundle of His, the bundle branches, and the Purkinje fibers. All right, let's look at pictures. All right, so what you're going to notice is up in the kind of upper corner of your right atrium, so this is my right atrium, I have my SA node. Okay, and then my AV node, so look at the name, atrioventricular, that's telling you that it's kind of between the atrium and the ventricle and that little wall right there. Okay, so what's going to happen is you're going to get a signal, okay, or in the SA node, actually, you have autorhythmic cells, which you're going to study more in your lecture class. You also will have sympathetic and parasympathetic innervation going to SA node, either stimulating it or hyperpolarizing it, okay? So if the SA node depolarizes, it's going to send a signal across the atria and down the atria, okay? And only the atria at this point in time through gap junctions, okay? And this allows the atria to contract as a single unit. Now, this signal is also gonna go to the AV node where it's gonna pick it up, and then the signal is gonna be transmitted down here. This is where your bundle of His or the atrioventricular bundle is. That takes the signal and it splits it into right and left bundle branches, okay? And then the bundle branches are gonna have little terminal fibers that we call Purkinje fibers. So here's one. Here's Purkinje fibers, here's Purkinje fibers, okay, up in here. Okay, now you'll notice when you look at this, here's your AV, your atria, here are your ventricles. The ventricles are considerably larger than your atria. It would be very difficult to get the signal to every single cell almost instantaneously in the ventricles, whereas you can do that in the atria because it's much smaller. So we take this signal and we bring it through so that by the time the signal gets here, here, and here, it's causing the depolarization of the adjacent cells, and then things start going through all the little gap junctions. And this basically means that essentially the ventricle can contract as a single unit. You just need to get the signal to a couple of different areas in order for it to be able to sufficiently move through the gap junctions quickly enough. Okay, so this is very important. Now, I want you to visualize, if you break that, what would not work? If you had a heart attack right there, would the ventricle still contract, or would it only be one section that doesn't contract? Okay, so this becomes really important when you start thinking about where infarcts occur, where heart attacks occur, because it could affect the contraction of just a very small part of the ventricular walls, or it could affect a very large part of the ventricular walls. So that is something to be thinking about. All right, moving on. All right, so with the intrinsic nodal system, we can measure the movement of the electrical signal, all right? Specifically those charged ions. All right, and we're going to do that through what we call an electrocardiogram, which can be an EKG or an ECG, depending on whether you're feeling English or German. Okay, so you've got the components. So the SA node right here, it sends its signal across here and here. That is going to correspond to the P wave on your electrocardiogram. So this is corresponding to atrial depolarization. So we see a little blip, and then it starts to relax, and then we get here, and then we get to the QRS complex. So during this time, the signal was coming here and moving to all of these places here. so that all of the ventricles contract it as once. That's a lot more area. So we get this huge signal on the myocardium, excuse me, on the electrocardiogram, and that is called the QRS complex. Now, while this is occurring, the atria were repolarizing, and that would have left a trace as well in terms of the change in electricity moving through, the change of the polar membrane, the polarity. But because the QRS complex is so big, it masks the repolarization of the P wave, okay? Now, that gets us over here, and now we've got a T wave. So the T wave is showing you the repolarization of ventricles. Because there's nothing else happening, you can see the little blippy thingy, okay? And then it goes back into the quiescent period. All right, just looking at another drawing, all right? So you can label this on your own. You've got your P wave, all right? The QRS complex, and then the T wave. And then over here, I've got the definitions for you. What you need to remember is that this is measuring the electrical current, okay? It isn't necessarily the same thing as a muscle contraction. We assume that if the electrical current is going through, that the muscle is contracting, and usually it is. But remember that this is all about the electrical current, and I want you to be able to visualize that. All right, I want to focus on some definitions that are constantly screwed up. So systole is referring to contraction, diastole is referring to relaxation, okay? So then systolic pressure in the arteries at peak of ventricular ejection. These are all critical components to that definition. You must get them all in there in that definition. Diastolic pressure in the arteries during ventricular relaxation, okay? Both of these concepts need to be in here, okay? Now, when you have someone's blood pressure as 90 over 60, the 90 is systolic pressure, and the 60 is diastolic pressure. All right, when you're measuring that pressure, what you are looking for is the change in sound in the brachial artery, okay? So basically, you've got your brachial artery right here, you put a blood pressure cuff on it, you squeeze the bulb, it cuts off the flow of circulation, there's no sound, okay? Now you start to ease off the bulb with the stethoscope placed over your antecubital fossa, and when you hear a sound come back, that is your systolic pressure. You continue to let the sound out, and when the sound disappears again, that is your diastolic pressure, okay? All right, you need to put together all the components of the cardiac cycle together. You need to figure out what works for you to figure that out, okay? Whether it's a flow chart like I've done here, or whether it's written out, or whether you draw diagrams, something, okay? So during the pause, during when your heart is kind of relaxing, we call this diastole of the entire heart. So this is the relaxation of the entire heart. Pressure is going to be low. There is blood moving. It's all passive. You've got passive filling of the atria and passive filling of the ventricles. So the AV valves need to be open, and they are, and the semilunar valves are closed. Now, some of the cells in the SA node are going to depolarize. This is called atrial systole now, so we've got contraction of the atria. The electrical signal being picked up will show up on the EKG as a P wave. So as you squeeze the rest of that blood out of the atria, you're increasing the pressure, and that shoots the rest of it in. You'll notice that the AV valve and the semilunar valve are the same as up there, okay? Now, the next step right here is ventricular systole. So systole meaning contraction, okay? The AV nodes pick up the electrical signal from the SA node, okay? It's gonna pass it along to all the Purkinje fibers, where eventually the signal is gonna go through all the gap junctions and the ventricles are going to contract. When they do that, intraventricular pressure increases, which is going to close the AV valves. And all these G's, for some reason, when I converted it, I turned them into G's. Those are all arrows, okay? That's really, really annoying that it did that. Okay, so the pressure increases. That snaps shut the semilunar valves. Okay, excuse me, the AV valves. Now, the pressure is continuing to increase in the ventricles, especially with the AV valves closed. So now it's really, really high, and that causes the semilunar valves to open. That pushes the blood from the ventricles into the pulmonary trunk and the aorta. During this time, the atria have been relaxing and passively filling with blood from the vena cavae and the pulmonary veins. Okay, now all of this corresponds to that QRS complex. All right, now we're going to get to the last part, which is ventricular diastole. So diastole meaning relaxation phase, okay? So as you repolarize the membrane, it creates a blip, a bump on your EKG that we call the T wave, okay? Now the pressure is going down in the ventricles. So now the pressure in the aorta and the pulmonary trunk are greater. That causes the semilunar valve to close. When it does that, a little bit of blood backflows, all right, and we call that the dicrotic nudge, okay? Now, as the ventricles pressure has dropped, the AV valves also reopened, okay? And now we are going to have passive filling of the atria and the ventricles all over again. And then you start the whole cycle over, okay? So I want you to write this out 10 times, getting all of these components on here. You need to get valves, EKG, pressure changes, diastole, systole, all right, all of it, all of those components need to get together when you are describing your cardiac cycle. All right, so with that cardiac cycle, we talked about the valves closing. So when you listen to a heartbeat through a stethoscope, usually people describe it as lub-dub pause, lub-dub pause, lub-dub pause. The sounds are created by the closing of the valves. So the AV valve closes at early ventricular systole, all right? Then the semilunar valve closes at ventricular diastole, okay? Now everything is pause, so everything is in diastole, okay? Let's see.